Here are the minimum requirements to use Ethernet IP with the Productivity Series CPUs. For the Productivity CPU to communicate to the Nitra valve, these are the communication parameters that we will need for this setup. So the input data is what we're reading from the valve, and the output data is what we're writing to. The input, as we see here, consists of a single byte, which is 8 bits. The output word consists of 2 bytes, or 16 bits, 1 bit for each possible solenoid on the valve block. To set up the CMV valve for Ethernet communication, you will need to obtain the Ethernet IP configuration tool from our website. So navigate to our site, and under Download, select Software. Find the Ethernet IP software, download, and install it into your PC. Once installed, open up the Ethernet IP configuration tool, and then select Scan for Devices. Once you see your OEM device, select and put in the IP address you need for your system. I'm going to use the following IP address for this example. So open up the Productivity project, double-click on the hardware configuration, and then select the Ethernet IP tab from the top. Now drag the generic client into the gray area in the middle. You can place an individual tag for each of these elements, or you could check the box Use Structure. This will create a structure of tags that can be used for this device, making it a lot easier on the program to create, use, and find the correct tags. I'm going to select Use Structure and give it the following name. Type in a name for this device. Type in the IP address that we configured into the CMV valve. The TCP port number for the CMV valve is always 44818. Now click on this green cross and select Add Explicit Message. All of these tags will also be part of the structure that we created before. This will be the polling rate for this device. I'm going to leave it at the default of 250 milliseconds. I highly recommend that the RPI time should not be any faster than the application requires. When you select OK, you will now be creating the tags that will make up this structure. Now that the client is configured, you will need to place 2 Ethernet IP explicit messaging instructions into your code, one for the input and one for the output data block. Let's begin with the input data, which is your read from the valve. Place the EMSG instruction into your code. Here I will also populate this instruction by the Use Structure option. Make sure to select the device name that we created in the hardware configuration. Now for connection, you have 2 options here. You have connected and unconnected. The main functional difference here is that if the connection is lost when using connected explicit messaging, all the valves will turn off. If you select unconnected and lose communication, the valves will stay in the last state sent to it. Now, since we're doing the read here, we'll be using the get attribute. And from the information that was provided before, we see that the instance ID is 101. Now, this is the part that catches some. The data array data type that we use here must match the data size of the input data block. So from this information, we see that this is done in bytes. So the data type of our data array must be an 8-bit data block. To create this data array, type in the name that you want for your data array, and when you click in the number of elements, the following will appear. Here we'll need to simply change the data type to 8-bit unsigned, and since we only need 1 byte, we can leave the columns as 1. Click OK. And then click OK on the instruction. This pop-up will complete the creation of the structure for this instruction. So that takes care of the read. Now let's enter the write instruction. We will input another EMSG instruction into our code. I'm going to put the following for the structure. When we get to the service, we'll be using the set to write to the valve. From the information that was provided earlier, we can see that the instance ID is 100. For the data array, we'll be using the following, and when you click on the number of elements, this pop-up will appear to create the array. As before, we will need to change the data type to 8-bit unsigned, but this time, since the block uses 2 bytes, we will need to change the column to 2 also. Click OK. Now, change the number of elements to 2. Click OK on the instruction, and this will complete the creation of the structure for this instruction. So that takes care of both the read and write instructions. Next, we need to be able to address the solenoid outputs in the output data block. From this table, we can see how the 2 bytes address each of the solenoids that are possible on the valve. So this would be how the outputs are distributed in the data array that we created for the output block. So to control this from our ladder code, I'm going to place a normally open contact with this boolean to trigger this bit of word that would address the first solenoid. Now, the last thing that we have to do here is enable the Ethernet IP communications. So if we go back to our Ethernet IP client, we can see that this tag will need to be turned on to enable the Ethernet IP connection. So I'm going to make a normally open contact with this boolean to trigger the enable of the communication. So that completes the ladder code that we're going to need for this example. Now transfer that to your CPU. With the project transfer, let's open up the data view and test our code. Let's enter the tags to enable the comms and control the solenoid into our data view. Send the edit to first enable the communication. Now send the edit to turn on the solenoid. You should immediately see the valve turn on. We can also view the status of the read by entering in the CMV read data array here. This table defines what the status word indicates on the valve. If you need any help with using an Automation Direct device, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning technical support team during regular business hours. They will be happy to help. And don't forget the forums. There's loads of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post questions directed at Automation Direct's technical support staff there. They do not monitor the forums on a regular basis.